Good morning, everyone. Welcome to those who are joining us in person, but also online. We gather together this morning to remember Margaret Irwin. I can still picture her sitting in that back corner there, faithfully worshiping God every morning, every Sunday. So it's with that image we are invited this morning to remember her in the presence of God and his people. Let's pray. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, we gather in your name, in your presence, to remember Margaret. We thank you that we can still be together. And we're grateful that that her memory continues to be a gift in our lives. So whether we live or die, we know we are in your hands and we will rest there, confident in your mercy and grace. Amen.
Margaret had a few favorite hymns that she always talked about, so we are going to sing them together. I invite you to stand as we sing "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross."
Good morning and welcome. I have to say I feel so ill-equipped to discuss Margaret and her incredible life, because I know her as a sister in Christ, which of course is a wonderful relationship, but I didn't really know her outside of the church. Most of how I knew her was through a Bible study that she and I attended and over many different lunches that we shared as part of that Bible study. But I got to know her in that lens that maybe not everyone else did. So the first thing I'd have to mention, of course, is that Margaret was a very, very proud mother of her son, David. And when she spoke of him, I would sometimes forget that he himself is a father and a grandfather, because she still had that mother's love for him. And of course, she had the love of her life. She married John in this church way back in 1970, and they were together for 47 years until his death about 4 years ago. And those are two of the important people from her family and from her life. I know she visited her sister whenever she could, and she kept in contact with so many people. But I can't speak on all of their behalf, so I can only speak on the limited exposure that her and I had together. There's a couple words that I think of when I think of her. One word, of course, is that she was smiling a lot. She was an honest person, open with her thoughts, and generous. And I think one word that sums her up in so many ways is dignity. She had a dignity about herself that was hers alone. She would tell me how she couldn't leave the house until she had put her face on. All the pictures I see of Margaret, she has her makeup on, her hair is perfect. She was always dressed appropriately. And she never said it to me as if it was wrong to go to church or somewhere without being dressed up and made up. It was that when she engaged the world, this is who she engaged the world as, her best self. And she wanted others to be able to engage with her that way. The idea of even visiting her in hospital, where she might not have her face on, seemed impossible to me, because that wasn't how she wanted me to see her. But that dignity she had extended into so many parts of her life. And because she had a great dignity about herself, she extended dignity to others. She wasn't vain, though. You can meet people who are very particular about how they dress and what they wear, and they can be very vain and worried about what other people think of them. That wasn't her at all. She had a humble beginnings. She was a humble person. And when she shared with other people, she recognized the dignity in those people as well. To make sure that you knew that she didn't come from privilege, she would often mention how she lived at Jane and Finch. And one of the last times she mentioned it, she chuckled and said, "Yes, I have to dodge the bullets to get into my apartment building." In the same time, though, she would talk about how much she loved that apartment. She loved that it looked over a ravine. And I remember being very confused, because I had looked at apartments in the Jane and Finch area, and I couldn't remember seeing a ravine. The truth is, she was a little bit closer to the edge of Jane and Finch. Yet, she had lived in that apartment for decades, and she did have two different break-ins. So, if she felt a little unsafe, that's understandable. The second break-in actually happened while she was having a nap, and the police officer had said how lucky she was that she had slept through it. I'm not sure it was her that was lucky, because she could be a very feisty woman. She had a sense of, I don't want to say lack of fear, but of trust in God. And that made her strong in facing challenges along life, and she had many. But the thing with Margaret was, if she started to talk about her apartment at Jane and Finch, she was very quick to mention the ravine. If she talked about the broken down van, she was very quick to talk about the mechanic who would help her fix it and who would give her a good, fair price. That was Margaret. She tried to live with an attitude of gratitude. Whereas some people could sugarcoat the things of their life and make it seem like it's not that bad, she would acknowledge the reality, but then remind herself and us, "But I really shouldn't complain." I love that about Margaret. When she said something, you heard the truth through her perception. You heard what she really believed, and you knew where you stood. Everything about Margaret flowed from her knowledge of who she was in Christ. We're all taught that we're to know who we are in Christ. Our identity is in Christ. It's not where we live or what we do for a living. But I think it takes a really long time for us to really live into that. And that is something that Margaret had learned through her years. She would always talk about how this was possible because of Christ. So she never took any kind of compliments to herself, but smile and say, oh, that's because of Christ. Often quoting the King James Version just to show that she knew exactly what she was talking about. This confidence in herself allowed her to speak up where many people in her generation and following would maybe be silent. She wasn't worried about what you thought when she said something. She simply had a truth that she wanted to share. And of course, in Bible discussions, there were many times where not everyone shared the same perspective. She was very sure in herself. And I can remember one day she said, I don't know why anyone cares about this. It's not important. And I was, it is important. It's important to me. But the beautiful thing about Margaret was she just stopped and looked at me and said, oh, really? It hadn't occurred to her there could be another point of view. But as soon as she heard there was, she was very curious to know what it was. And she didn't roll over either. She'd say, yes, I can see that, but I still think I'm right. That was the wonderful thing. Margaret was so sure of who she was that if you disagreed with her, it didn't take away from her. She didn't wear it. She didn't take it personally. It was just a conversation. When I mentioned that apartment building she lived in, you can imagine that she had lived there many, many decades. And you can imagine that over time, the diversity, the water she swam in, so to speak, changed considerably. And sometimes she would come and she'd say, oh, there's this group of people. And she'd have questions. Why do they do what they do? But at the same time, she always was managed to befriend them and made friends. She would ask her questions, and they would give their answers. And though maybe she didn't think that their perspective was quite right, that was okay, because she was secure in who she was. And she had told us, I remember one Mother's Day, that someone had, a Muslim lady down the hall from her, had given her a gift for Mother's Day. This is the kind of woman Margaret was, that when you met her, you felt at peace. It was okay that you didn't necessarily understand each other, because there was a goodness there. Everything about Margaret was this confidence and this truthfulness. It was something that I really enjoyed. But there was also another side to her. There was a quietness about her that I didn't quite pick up on right away. We mentioned that she used to sit in the back pew, and I used to wonder why, because it's hard to hear back there, and it's hard to see if you're shorter like myself. But I was sitting there this morning and reflecting how back there, I could see every single person in this room. And you may have been one of the many of people who received many of one of her hundreds of cards that she had sent out since starting here. If she had heard of a milestone birthday, you would receive a card. If she heard a couple got married, you would receive a card. Someone died in your family, again a card. And if you had a new addition to your family, those were her favorite. She would want to know, what's the baby's name? Does anyone know what the baby's name is? She loved that people were growing families here. And you would get a card. I was lucky to get one of those cards. I can't remember if it was an anniversary or a birthday, but it came with a little Tim Hortons card. And there was a little note, and it said something like, it's not much, but have a treat on me. And you know, that just made my whole, maybe more than my day. It was like somebody notices me while I'm thinking about something else. I think of her sitting in that big pew, in back pews, noticing us. I have a story from when she was in Bible study with us, and it just talks so much about who she was to notice others. One of our Bible study members had brought one of her charges to group one time. Very boring place for a young boy to be, and Margaret took a notice of him and would often ask in other sessions, how's he doing, what's going on? And then after Halloween one year, she brought a little baggie of those little chocolates, and she said to the person, you know, do you think he would like this? I have some leftovers. She was assured, yes. Oh my goodness, yes, he loves chocolate and treats and candies. He would be thrilled. So she gave him this little treat. And the next week we came in, she still had some Halloween candy left over, another little bag. Oh, I thought he might like this. And then the next week, and then the next week. And it got to the point where she would just slide a little bag of candy over to that person to take home for him. And I guess at the time I was a little cynical. I thought, well, every kid likes candy. Is there any meaning to this? But then when Margaret died, that little boy who's now a young man was asked, do you remember Margaret? And he said, yes, she was that nice woman at the church that always gave me a treat. I think the act of being noticed was one of the greatest gifts that Margaret gave to people. And that wasn't from a sense of duty. It wasn't from a sense of, I have to do this. It was just from who she was and who she was in Christ. The one last thing I have to say about Margaret is she was a worshiper. I know that many of us come to Sunday to worship. It's part of what we do. But on some Sundays, I have to say, my mind's not really on it. And sometimes I'm anxious to see a friend. Sometimes I'm tired and I'm not really alert. Wherever Margaret was, she was a worshiper. Even as she said to people, oh, I have to remember to be thankful, she was worshiping God. When someone complimented her and she said, oh, it's because of Christ, she was worshiping God. And she worshiped not just here at Spring Garden, but she worshiped for many, many years up at her trailer in Campbellford. I don't even know where Campbellford is, but I've heard of Campbellford Baptist so many times from Margaret. And I got the sense that if she chose her favorite place to worship, their style might have been a little more in keeping with the old hymns that she loved. But it didn't matter whether it was here or there. She worshiped fully. And long before I learned how to worship on Zoom, she started worshiping at home through TV, through different TV programs when she couldn't make it out to church. Worship didn't end because she couldn't come here, because God was still there, ready to receive. These are just small snippets of what I know of Margaret from being in group with her. I know other people have known her far longer. If there's anybody who would like to come up and share something that you remember of Margaret, something that was funny or meaningful, I do really encourage you to come up, because, like I said, I knew her as a sister in Christ, which was a very wonderful way to know her. But I didn't know her the way some other people did. So if there's anyone who would like to come up, please do so.
Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Monica, did you want to come up and share? Yeah.
I just want to say, I told Victoria before this, is that I've actually saved an answering machine message from Mark Irwin. We didn't get technological enough, but it was so precious. I think we both had diabetes. She had type 2 and I had type 1, so she would always check on my blood sugar. And so whenever, I don't like them, but she loves those sugar-free candies. So every once in a while, we'd like mail her a pack of sugar-free candies. Anyway, she called to say thank you. And she listed almost every single one of you to be like, and Victoria did this, and Garth and Anne did this. And, you know, she listed every single person. So I want to just say that it was really neat how much Spring Garden cared for her. And she really was, with her awesome hair and smile as she waited for her ride. So, Margaret, we will dearly miss you, and we do miss you. So if anyone wants to hear that message, I'll see if we can find it.
Hi. Margaret was a very good friend to my Aunt Dorothy and John. And my aunt lived alone for the last number of years of her life in an apartment on Yonge Street. And every week, never failed, she'd get a call from Margaret and she'd say, okay, I'm sending John out for blah, blah, blah. What do you want? And my aunt always kept a list by the phone and John would bring it to the door. And I remember being there one time and I was going out to do her groceries and they called and she said, oh no, darling, you don't have to go. John's gonna come. And I thought, well, poor John. I said, just tell him it's okay, I'm here. And she goes, no, it's okay. So John came to the door. It took him like 3 trips up from his car because my aunt, if you knew her at all, Coke. So in order to keep her stocked, he wouldn't bring one case. He'd bring like 3, and the poor man, I mean, you know, he'd be carrying all this stuff up. And I'd say to him, you know, do you want me to come down? Is there more? And he said, no, no, no. But he'd keep coming back up. And then Margaret would phone, and she'd say, did he come? And we'd say, yes, he came. And she'd say, okay, on Thursday, he has to go to this drugstore. What do you want from there? So she was great.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. This is one of the most famous and popular psalms in the Bible. The psalm has resonated with so many people as it speaks to the goodness of God, his loving care, protection, and presence. It's the psalm that we can all relate to as all of us go through the valley of the shadow of death. And we all need to know that we are not alone. When you read the psalm, you cannot help but be drawn to the psalm. It is a psalm that speaks to who God is, his goodness, his loving provision, and care for his people. The psalmist starts the psalm with the understanding that the Lord, or in Hebrew, Yahweh, is my shepherd, I shall not want. The psalmist recognizes who God is, that is, God is Yahweh, the one who is the great I am, the one who is with his people. And that secondly, the psalmist is not lacking in anything because he or she recognizes that Yahweh is with him. And when Yahweh is with him, he is cared for, provided for, protected, and loved. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. Yahweh is the one that restoreth my soul. And it is he who leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. For his name's sake. His name, Yahweh. When Moses received this name from God, Yahweh promised them that he would be with him. That Moses can face Pharaoh, which could have meant death, because Yahweh promised that he is with him. And the first word of the psalm starts with that word, Yahweh. And it is because of who Yahweh is that the psalmist can find rest for his soul, where he lacks nothing. I was told that this passage is Margaret's favorite passage in the Bible. And I wondered, what is the mindset that helps someone speak these words and believe in them? Margaret Irwin was someone who loved these words because these words rung true for her. For her, she knew that even though she entered the valley of the shadow of death, she knew she was not alone. She believed that God was with her in the good times and the bad. And when Victoria shared that she looked out into her ravine, I could imagine her picturing this, that Yahweh was leading her to green pastures and to the still waters. I only knew Margaret for a little while, but I do remember her saying to me once, right after Jean had retired and we were looking into what we were going to do in terms of who was going to be the next pastor. And she came up to me one Sunday after church and she said, "You know, pastors come and go, but the church will still be here." And I remember thinking, yeah, that's true. It's the people that make up the church, and Margaret has been faithfully been attending Spring Garden for so long, and as long as people can remember. So pastors can come and go, but people like her will continue to be the church. And I was told of her card ministry and for her care for others, as Victoria shared, and how she faithfully wrote cards and mailed them out until she passed away. And she thought more about others than herself. And I was told she was also a prayer warrior who prayed for others all the time. I was also told that Margaret would have wanted this memorial to be a time where people would not just remember her, but to remember who she put her faith in. She believed in her Lord Jesus, who was her shepherd. And she loved this psalm because it spoke to the truth of her long abiding faithfulness in Jesus. So a question that arises from her life and her death and her faith is, who do we put our faith in? Who do we put our hope in that would allow us to recite this psalm as if it were our own? What are the places of the valley of the shadow of death in our lives? During COVID, it feels as though all of us are walking through some type of a valley. And whether it's COVID, mental health issues, loss of a loved one, how can we walk through such places with hope? The psalmist and Margaret would say that we need to put our hope and faith in Jesus as our shepherd. He will guide you, he will protect you, and he will restore you because he loves you. The life and death of Margaret Irwin points to her Lord Jesus, who died and rose again so that we can dwell in the house of the Lord forever. As we celebrate and remember Margaret this morning, let us be aware that her Lord Jesus loves us very much and calls us to put our trust in him, so that we can all walk through the valley of the shadow of death and will fear no evil. I think her card to us would be this morning is that may we trust in Jesus our shepherd and dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Just before we sing, I would like to, Garth and I were the recipients of many cards and Tim Horton's cards. And in the last couple years, and especially once COVID started, I started sending Margaret cards. And she was thrilled to get them and phone calls and, you know, just that little connection and just to reach out to someone. And I feel like, you know, when I do that, I remember Margaret and that ministry that she had. Yeah, she was a great blessing.
Mm-hmm. For me, it was pot of gold. I used to get a box of pot of gold every Christmas. Yeah. One thing I loved about Margaret was she was surprising. She wasn't really what you thought she was in so many ways or would assumed. And one thing is that, you know, she loved her old hymns, but yet, I don't know how many times throughout the years, she told me that this next one was one of her favorite songs. And it's from 1995. and just, what? Really? But this is one of her favorites. And so we're going to sing it to both in honor and memory of her, but also this is a message she cared deeply about. So please stand with us as we worship God together.
Beyond
Please pray with me. God, this day we thank you especially for the life of Margaret. We thank you for all that she has meant to us. We especially remember with gratitude who she was and the life and the hope and the faith that she had in you. We thank you for her faith in you and all that we saw of you through her. As we remember, help us to commit ourselves anew to your service so that our thanksgiving for Marg might show itself in a readiness to be faithful to your will. This we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. So now as you go, may the love of the Lord Jesus draw you to himself. May the power of the Lord Jesus strengthen you in his service. May the joy of Lord Jesus fill your whole being. May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.